it just keeps going. Julie, how great is that necklace right now?
I love it. I love it so much.
All right, are we ready to vote? All right, without question, one of the craziest tribals I have ever had the pleasure of witnessing.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. That didn't take long now, did it? Just a click of a button, and here we are back in the top 10 craziest tribal councils in Survivor, finishing off the rankings with the number 5 through number 1 spots. In the event that you're watching this before watching part 1, I strongly, strongly recommend watching the first part so you can have a fuller, more complete experience understanding what's already been said and where I stand with what I believe is shaping up to be full-on bonkers in the tribal councils left to be discussed. If I left something out of this video, it's very possible it was just in part 1. I also just don't want you to call me out for things that I left out when I probably didn't. Or maybe I did. That being said, let's talk about the craziest tribal councils to ever happen. We get to trim the fat away and get to the juicy meat of the Outback Steakhouse prime rib, take a Charmin shower, and get drunk on all of the outhouse wine possible as we move on to the number 5 craziest tribal.
You know what, Jeff? I think it would be downright depressing to sit and watch green bananas turn yellow without my debaucherous little villains. So, Sandra, that's for you.
Get out of here, for real.
Number 5. There's something to be said about rocks on Survivor that always make things just a tad bit more exciting. Between eating them, to picking them out of a bag, to just putting them in your pocket, you can't help but get excited at the prospect of a rock showing up on your TV screen one more time. Which is exactly what happens at the final 6 of Survivor Blood vs. Water, when we see a 3-3 deadlock vote go to a rock draw that unfortunately eliminates Tina Weston's daughter, Katie, from the game. This tribal council is one of my favorites, and maybe even just objectively one of the best tribals in all of Survivor, largely because of how bombastic, gritty, desperate, and organic it all feels. You have a classic situation where majority alliance of 4 outnumbers a minority alliance of 2, and the vote on paper seems pretty straightforward. But the end of Survivor necessitates that only 3 people can sit at the final tribal council, which means an alliance of 4 will always have somebody on the bottom, whether they know it or not. One of those 4 cannot reach the end, and if that person recognizes that they are that number 4, maybe it's time to do something about it. Like, make a big move. MVP of this tribal is without a doubt 100% Hayden Moss, the so far one and only person to ever play in both Big Brother and Survivor. Oh, wait. Oh, all right. Caleb played too. Okay. Why was Hayden not brought back for Game Changers? No, seriously. I think Hayden pulled off one of the most game-changing moves in the history of Survivor with this Tribal Council performance. And it's all because of just how good he is at pitching his case and dispelling bullshit.
4 is better than 6, which immediately means, Sierra, you're number 4. If you came on this side, there is no 4, 5, or 6. There's 1, 2, and 3, or 1, 2, and 3, however you frame it.
That's incorrect.
What do you mean that's incorrect?
What she has on that side is a backstabber, a liar, a liar.
Okay.
What she has on this side is honest words, people who keep their word, and keep it all together.
Why is the jury laughing?
Mind you, spoilers for Big Brother. This is a man who already won Big Brother before, which I believe is an even more complicated game than Survivor on paper, and now here he is making mincemeat of Tyson and his coconut bandits. While Tyson does luck out and doesn't draw the wrong color rock, it's easily Hayden who walks out of this tribal the true winner, despite getting voted out in the next episode anyway. What I love most about this tribal council and why it is so high in what I believe are the craziest tribals ever, it just feels so raw. I mean, yeah, you have Katie, who pretty much doesn't do anything, which means it's all Hayden on a sinking ship fighting for his life like a crazy madman, and he is seriously rallying up his competition in Monica, Jervis, and Tyson. He calls out cracks in their logic and proves the better debater when ultimately he does convince the person who is sitting at number 4 in that alliance, Sierra, the lady at the bottom, to switch sides, to take a chance. I believe that seeing this move right here is what sparked the quote-unquote big moves era of Survivor, and between Hayden, Sierra, Tyson, and Jervis all debating with insults and shouting and just straight up compelling television, you finally get an organically, as in there are no twists necessary, tribal council where the person at the bottom actually does what everyone in the audience is yelling at their TV to do. It's just such a pleasure to watch, from the opening question to the moment that Jeff snuffs the torch.
Don't hate the players, homie. Hate the game. This isn't Big Brother, it's Survivor. We do things different here. You're about to get a lesson in how to play the game.
Number 4. When I think of craziest tribal councils in all of Survivor, this next one is always the first one to spring to my mind. I'll give you a hint.
Let's try it!
The Three Amigos. They were the biggest stars of their day.
The Three Amigos are history.
It was the Three Amigos from Survivor Karamoan when, at the final 10, they were down in numbers 7-3, but then Malcolm pulled out two idols out of thin air and, along with Reynolds having the immunity necklace, suddenly found themselves in a completely bulletproof situation where all guns were pointed their way.
Welcome. Yeah, I'll hang out with you
welcome
guys.
Welcome to the bottom.
It was the right call. I don't feel too bad about it.
It's actually not that bad being down here. We have nothing to really be afraid of.
This is true. Right.
Nobody talks behind our back because we're at the bottom. Right. You know what I mean?
To me, this is one of the most purely fun as we get crazy tribal councils just because the situation is so unlikely to happen. Malcolm had two idols in his pocket, one from the pre-merge and one he found in the exact same episode as this tribal council. Meanwhile, Reynolds, one of the other three amigos, won the immunity challenge in the same episode, meaning he was safe from receiving any votes. The first third of this tribal council is actually kind of peaceful, which is amusing thinking about what happens right after, but that's largely because only Malcolm and the viewing audience know about this insane predicament that's about to unfold. So in the conversation switches to how the three amigo boys are being left out and basically treated like they have the plague, and then Malcolm gives this fantastic transition into, oh yeah, by the way, about that.
But this is supposed to be a game, so we figured we'd do something about it. And tonight we're gonna try to. So this is the other immunity idol I've been hanging on to. I'm giving it to Eddie. Yeah, I had that one for a while. I just found the other one today.
I love when players pull aces out of their sleeves, and this one is priceless. The Alliance of Seven has no idea what to do, and the reactions across the board are phenomenal. Malcolm also does tell everyone that the three amigos plan to vote for Philip, which I actually think was fantastic to hear from a viewing perspective, but probably not the best move if you're Malcolm. Now, Malcolm, I think, does admit this too. I think this proclamation kind of hurts this tribal, because he basically gives the majority a scapegoat, which allows them to avoid turning on each other. All in all, it is a crazy situation with one of the craziest tribals of all time, but there are still three more that I think have managed to improve upon the foundation that this one paved. Number three. In case you haven't noticed, every single tribal thus far on this list is from a season not that long ago. And guess what? That's not changing. Number three is from one of my favorite seasons in recent history. It's when Debbie gets blindsided in Survivor Korong in a 4-3-2 final nine vote that's just as amazing as a 4-3-2 vote outcome can be expected to be.
Certainly, I'm not gonna just lay down and say, hey, good game. The only thing we can do right now is fight, and so we're going to fight. And if fighting means making everybody else miserable in the process, that's what I'm doing.
Now, there is a lot to dissect with this tribal, so let's just start at the top. First, we do have that minority three with two idols. But this season is a twist where if you combine two normal idols, they will form together to make a super idol that can be used after the votes are read instead of before the votes are read. At the same time, we had a big alliance of women, plus Grandpa Joe, who wanted nothing more than to get these men out of the game. There was a lot of tension at this tribal because at the top of the episode, you had Scott, Jason, and Ty, who all decided to act like sore losers by pouring out the water, getting rid of the fire, hiding the machete, and just being unpleasant people since they got blindsided at the previous tribal council. Great sports, that lot. The women wanted to split the vote to counter an idol, but Aubrey didn't really want to work with Julia because Julia was clearly very close with the boys. It put the women's alliance at odds, and when Aubrey saw that Debbie trusted Julia wholeheartedly, she realized she could actually hatch a plan to weaken Julia and flush any idols out at the same time.
It's killing me that Debbie is going with her emotion right now. Scott poured that water on the fire because he wanted a reaction. And I want to tell Debbie, you're being emotional, but you have to be logical right now.
Fast forward to the tribal council, and we have a lot of tension building up, as you can clearly tell, especially when talk begins around the idol. Ty reveals he has an idol, not much of a shocker, but then Jason also reveals that he has an idol too.
Wait a minute. The idol's got a brother. There's two of them.
All right.
Wow.
Two idols? Are you kidding me? It really is the three evil amigos. But what makes it better than the previous one is that beyond just the frantic whispers once both idols are revealed, is both how dramatic and clever this tribal really is. On the surface, it was intended to be fireworks. You know, When two idols get revealed by the minority, you're gonna get fireworks. And they did. The evil three amigos feel powerful and are giddy with confidence. They're smiling all tribal as they chew the scenery from corner to corner, playing up their position to rattle the majority. But beyond all of these fireworks, these dramatics, we have the true power of the tribal from four women in particular. Aubrey, Sydney, Julia, and Michelle aren't nearly as shook as they let on. They do need to play up their fear to sell the blindside and flush the idols, and that's because they intended to blindside Debbie. I think in a normal season, Jason, Scott, and Ty would probably play their idols, but here they felt safe behind this odd twist. Which does lend itself to an even crazier tribal when, despite all of these theatrics, the rock, paper, scissors, Rochambeau, wait, Shambo's on this season? Ty sits down and doesn't play his idols, and yet, despite the men thinking they've shocked everyone, it's the four women who come together, who come out on top when they blindside Debbie. Ah, craziness. I've talked too much. Let's keep going. Number two. I truly believe no matter which order I place these two tribals in, they are the absolutely two craziest tribal councils in all of Survivor, without a doubt. And we're talking over 500 tribal councils to consider here. The number two spot goes to the fourth tribal council of Survivor Game Changers, when two tribes came together in the pre-merge portion of the season to vote together in a twist never seen before and kinda hopefully we will never see again. And even though I'm personally not a fan, no matter the outcome, I can't deny how utterly crazy the tribal came to be even before the infamous moment JT got out of his chair and whispered into Brad Culpepper's ear. The numbers in this tribal council were 6 versus 5, and because it was tribe versus tribe and not just alliance versus alliance, it looked pretty straightforward. However, there was already a tribe swap in the season, and so JT, who was part of the 6, was really good allies with many of the members in the minority 5. Meanwhile, Haley, who was in the 5, was an original ally with several members in the 6. Both sides weren't sure if either JT or Haley would flip on their numbers to aid their original allies or stick with their current tribe to maintain a better footing in the game in the present moment.
Oh, look how the tables have turned. I mean, I have options. I could go with this tribe, but I could also flip. There's so many different dynamics going on that you need to consider your short-term and long-term game at the same time in this vote.
But it does need to be said, the Alliance of Six was trying to deduce if Haley wanted them to vote a certain way. Meanwhile, whispers were already happening across the board even before all hell broke loose. Information is power in Survivor, and so JT, being the daredevil that he is, seized the opportunity amidst the chatter to get up and go directly to his number one ally on the other side, Brad.
If that's how we're gonna be. Wow.
I can do that. It's better for us, I promise.
Swear. Swear. It's on you.
How are you doing?
I'm scared.
It's like the British House of Commons, impossible to subdue or make sense of, but still a spectacle in every sense of the word. Huddles happen at tribal council. That's right, huddles, like in American football. Both tribes huddle separately and discuss their plan. I believe Probst is the most amazed he's ever been in 17 years of filming this show. We even have Haley, who says she's not ready to vote right after Probst announces it's time to vote.
I didn't consent.
You're not ready.
Haley, we can vote. We can vote.
Yeah, we can vote.
All right, let's vote. You may regret it, but I'll go.
And then, as if this wasn't crazy already, an idol gets played. Ty plays it for Sierra, and it's played correctly. It looks like JT's plan is coming to fruition until, until it doesn't. Surprise, surprise, right? Brad's alliance decides to target Malcolm instead of Sandra. Probably not a bad move no matter how you shake it. And suddenly, the lovable golden boy turned rogue maverick has his lifeline cut short as millions of fans around the world scream in shock and awe. Was all of this really worth it to sacrifice Malcolm to the Survivor gods? Regardless, there is no doubt in my mind this tribal council is in the top two. And really, it probably in some ways should be number one, but I can't ignore what's about to unfold with the number one, so let's keep this crazy bus chugging along as we move on to what I like to present to you as what I believe is the craziest tribal council to ever happen in all of Survivor. Number one. I've done a lot of talking, explaining, yelling in this video, and while I can't show you the entire number one tribal council? In this case, I don't actually think I need to. Maybe I'm being hyperbolic, surprise, but I don't think so. The number one craziest tribal council in all of Survivor is going to go to the final seven tribal council of Survivor, Heroes versus Healers versus Hustlers. In every tribal council on this list, all of them have had some filler moments at some point in the tribal. A question, a comment, something that doesn't necessitate your attention as a viewer. In this tribal, it's the only one from start to finish that doesn't stop giving you, the viewer, the fan, exactly what you want from a tribal council at every second. All seven players are alive, are playing the game hard, are giving some fantastic sound bites and one-liners, and are at each other's throats ready for an all-out bloodbath. That's one of the defining aspects I noticed here that none of the other tribal councils had. Every second of this tribal builds upon the last, and every second is viciously fantastic. Even the first question to Devin about giving up immunity opens a can of shit-stirring to the next level that starts the motors for Ben, Ashley, Lauren, and everyone in between. Unlike the number two tribal, we didn't have 11 players here to go to for great lines or succulent drama. We had only seven fully fleshed out, first-time players who are playing as if they were in an all-star season. To me, that's some of the highest praise you can get, and it's why I both love this tribal council and believe its craziness is of the highest, highest caliber. We have the majority four alliance versus the minority three, but Ben, who's in the majority four, isn't happy with what's happening behind closed doors. He's privy to double dealings and he wants to shake things up. Making a move against Lauren, he attempts to point the guns her way instead of his own, which is where we start the tribal council. Immediately, all of the tension bubbles to the surface after only a single question. All of it is so raw, yet so strategically sound, which I love. And unlike some other seasons on this list, we understand and are able to follow every storyline leading up to these moments, which makes it all the better translated when the proverbial shit hits the fan. Talk of Lauren's double vote comes up, which she bluffs about saying she left it back at camp. Spoilers, she didn't, it was in her pocket. And then there's her bizarre idol, which for the first time ever came in two parts. And she gave one of the parts to Dr. Mike to gain his loyalty. But then he decides to buy some stock in the crazy sector and gets up, throws his half into the fire, and says, nope, not having it.
This is the real idol, and I wanted to do this for like 15 years. It will never be played.
We've seen many fake idols, clues, and even hats get thrown into a fire, but an actual idol just burning there in front of everyone. Oh, and speaking of fake idols, we also had a fake idol at this tribal council too that Ben made himself that looked incredibly authentic compared to the real one, and he wore it all tribal because why not? We get the closest thing to an auction we've seen in five seasons when a bidding war starts for Lauren's double vote, and then the whispers. Bring on the whispers. No crazy tribal is complete without them. Commotion breaks out. All seven of the castaways are rambling at once. Are you kidding me? Just look at this. The jury is completely baffled, Probst is completely baffled, and I'm in Survivor heaven.
Blackmail for an extra vote, what might be an idol burning in the fire. It really is absolute chaos.
You can't be in the conversation for top two without someone getting out of their seat, which is exactly what Devin does as he approaches Mike. And then Chrissy gets up and approaches Ryan, and then Mike approaches Chrissy, all the while the two biggest targets, Ben and Lauren, are just sitting there waiting.
Let's get rid of Ben. He's going to
everyone. You can go. I don't care.
I'm not going anywhere.
Go ahead.
I'm scared. I'm not going anywhere.
Are you talking if you want?
We don't need Chrissy or Ryan. Let's just get it over with.
If you would have just said, okay, Danny, let's do it.
Nope.
Wow. And, of course, as if all of this wasn't enough, an idol gets played. Just check that box. Ben plays his idol, perhaps the only secret of this entire tribal, and negates the vote of every single person other than himself. All six votes were for him, and none of them counted. And here's a fun fact. This is the first and only time in all of Survivor and all 35 seasons up to this point that this scenario has happened, where a player was sent packing with just a single vote to their name in a final tally of 1-0. Beat by beat, this tribal council is the craziest ever, maybe of all time. I don't know what else there is to say. And that, ladies and gentlemen, are the top 5 and top 10 craziest tribal councils in the history of Survivor.
I'm having like this real bipolar reaction to everything because the Survivor fan of me is sitting at home saying, what the hell just happened? This is the most exciting freaking tribal council I've ever seen. People are whispering to each other. Voting plans are changing, which is extraordinarily rare at tribal council.
But do you agree with me on the top five? On my decision for number one? Let me know in the comments down below, what do you think is the craziest tribal council ever? Feel free to subscribe for all the Survivor goodness. As always, my name is Peridiam. I hope you guys enjoyed the video, and I will see you in the next one as soon as I reach into the fire and grab the other half of the idol, that is.
As a competitor, I've always said, you know what, keep your fate in your own hands, but there's so many things weighing on my mind. I've made a lot of mistakes in the past couple days, and I know that actions do speak louder than words. I want to give individual immunity to Natalie.